Well, hello everyone. Welcome to another live stream of Let Us Reason. I'm your host Al Fadi, and with me here a very special friend, Regis Matthew. You can see his name, but I know some of you usually think that we always have to bring, you know, the Jay Smith and the David Woods and the Sam Chamones, and that's not me, by the way. On my platform, I love to bring people who are genuinely working hard to reach the lost, and in this case, reach Muslims. Nothing against my brothers, Sam Chamone or David Wood or Jay Smith. They're doing amazing work, but we want to also give a platform to those who are behind the scenes, to those who nobody knows that they're doing what they're doing. And I, if you are following me on Facebook, you'll know that you've came across Regis many times. He makes wonderful comments. I love his style of challenging those who are distractors, those who are, you know, come in as if they know what the Bible says, and so on and so forth. And then in about, I would say about 3 weeks ago, maybe, brother, if I recall, I came across your video that you did about Zakir Naik, and it was hilarious. I mean, I have to say, I was laughing, you know, when I saw what you did with the video. You butchered, you know, everything about what he said. I discovered that if I would have came across Zakir Naik's video the first time, I would have concluded that Zakir Naik is a gay, that Zakir Naik is not a Muslim, that Zakir Naik mocks, you know, his own faith. Why? Because you took things out of context and you put them all in a way to prove your point that once you take something out of context, all of a sudden the whole picture changes. True. Well, with that says, enough about me, of course. I want to just welcome you again, my brother. And why don't you take a few minutes to give people enough about yourself, background, your journey to Christ, and then we'll talk about your ministry.
Well, thank you so much, Brother Al Fadi, for having me on your Let Us Reason show. We hope and pray that today's session will bless many people. Before I even begin telling anything about me, you know, I want to thank you, brother, for your amazing life, for your testimony. You know, your story of how God brought you back to him is just so amazing. And I'm sure that your listeners and followers over here will agree with me in this thing that the first thing I noticed about you, brother, is your humility. You know, in spite of being so knowledgeable, such a fine scholar yourself, such an amazing believer, you're a very humble man of God, you know. So that's the first thing I noticed about you. And I really want to thank you for that. I want to thank you for your wonderful ministry on the social media, such as Sira International, and then on YouTube and your Facebook page. And another thing I really must say, brother, is that this Let Us Reason show is so unique, brother. You know, as you rightly said, you know, there are so many big names out there in the world of Christian apologetics, such as yourself, Brother Sam, David Wood, Dr. Jay Smith, and many others. You know, these wonderful believers, you know, they are doing such an amazing work in God's kingdom. They are serving God in wonderful ways. But, you know, there are many such believers out there who are trying to serve God in their own little way, you know. There are many relatively unknown and budding apologists, you know, out there. They also want to minister unto God. They want to share their gifts and be useful in God's kingdom. So typically what your show does, brother, is it gives these small and budding apologists a medium and a platform to share our gifts and also use these platforms for, you know, evangelism and apologetics. So, and I would go as far as saying that yours is perhaps the only show that I know of in the Christian apologetics world that gives a voice to, you know, newer and relatively unknown apologists. So
well, I think it's the whole purpose, brother. Pray glory to God for that.
Yes, it's a very, very unique show, and I really thank God for your ministry. And, you know, the first thing when we met for the first time and we talked, you know, when I mentioned this point, you know, the first thing that you said is, you know, that you believe in helping others in the body of Christ. So that's one thing that really stuck with me that, you know, wow, what an amazing and humble believer. So thank you, Brother Al Fadi, for your ministry.
Brother. And by the way, just a secret, I was just notified that you sing. Okay, so I'm just telling you, I'm being told that you sing something new. I didn't know about that.
I try, brother. I'm not a trained singer, and
I have my spies, you know, they know things about you.
I'll have to be careful then. Well, anyway, a little bit about myself. My name is Ritesh Matthew, and I was born and raised in India. I also did my schooling and college over there. I was born in a Christian home, but I wasn't a born-again Christian. I was simply just another nominal Christian. I didn't have any relationship with God. But I did attend, you know, my local church on Sundays pretty faithfully. However, I had no desire in spiritual things or any desire to know God. I was simply living my life as a, you know, nominal Christian. And whether or not God existed, it was pretty irrelevant to me. In other words, I wasn't seeking God consciously. So that was my, you know, days in India. Now, after I completed my school and college, you know, I had passed a few exams and I got a government job in India. Now, I don't know if you know, but to be able to get a government job in an overpopulated country like India, you know, it's a big deal. It's like winning a jackpot, you know. So my career was all set. I was very thrilled and excited to get a government job at such a young age. But let's just put it this way. There was a turn of events in my life. And due to some personal reasons, I had to apply for a U.S. student's visa. So I got the student's visa and I came to the U.S. in 1999. Now, when I came to the U.S., you know, I came alone. My immediate family and everyone was left behind. They were in India. I started studying for my program in Chicago in 99. And prior to this, brother, you know, I had lived a very wonderful life in India. I had so many friends, relatives, and, you know, family back home. I was actively involved in sports, music, and many other activities. And I felt like my life was, you know, all set after I got the government job. However, when I migrated to the U.S., you know, everything suddenly changed for me. I was very, very lonely. I felt really very lonely. There was a lot of hardship for me in every possible way you can imagine. I felt like I really had to start my life all over again. I was really very heartbroken, brother. I was really missing my family, my friends, and my wonderful life in India. So within just a matter of a couple of months after my arrival to the US, you know, I slipped into depression, actually. I was psychologically very devastated. And within just a couple of months of my arrival, you know, I was completely drained, you know, emotionally, physically, financially, psychologically, spiritually, in every ways I felt I was exhausted and really very drained. Well, you know, initially in my foolishness, you know, I started blaming God for everything that was happening in my life. You know, that's how we operate, right? Normally, when things are hale and hearty, you know, we seldom thank God or remember Him. But when things go wrong in our lives, you know, we are so quick to blame God. So I was also so foolish and ignorant at that time. You know, I started questioning God. Why did you bring such a sudden, you know, and depressing change in my life? However, you know, very soon I realized that, you know, I had not searched God my entire life up to that point. I was never interested in seeking Him or knowing Him. So I realized, you know, that I had no right to blame or question God for what was happening in my life. Well, to cut the long story short, you know, I found a Holy Bible that was kept in my bag. It was in my native language. And immediately, you know, I figured out that my parents had put that Bible for me on purpose, you know. You see, brother, no one in this world knows you better than your own parents, I guess, you know.
Amen.
Yeah, due to my personality, you know, they knew how I was. And, you know, perhaps my parents had figured out that I would feel very lonely, devastated, and depressed by being alone in the U.S. So on purpose, you know, they had put a Holy Bible for me. I started to read the Holy Bible seriously for the first time in my life, brother. And I tell you, you know, for the first time in my life, I felt like the Holy Bible verses were like jumping out of the pages and reaching deep down in my heart. I felt like the Bible verses were actually, you know, talking to me. And for the first time, I felt like the verses were, you know, of our Holy Bible were just not some script or some text, but they were very real, you know. God's words, you know, they started to comfort me and give me so much hope and peace. I fell deeply in love with the Holy Bible. I actually got so addicted to the Holy Bible, you know. Day and night, I started to meditate on God's words. And I even kept my academic studies aside and I started to read God's word with so much passion, you know. And I wouldn't even read my academic studies but would read the Bible all day long. At that time, I really didn't know what was happening to me. You know, I thought I went totally crazy or what, you know, what I was doing at that time. Nevertheless, you know, at that point also, I wasn't born again Christian. I hadn't confessed my sins. I hadn't accepted Jesus Christ in my heart. Well, long story short, again, you know, one day I was in my college computer lab, and it was late evening, and there was nobody in the computer lab at that time. You know, I remember that evening, you know, I was so burdened in my heart. I was really very overwhelmed, and I felt like I couldn't take it any longer. You know, I was really convicted of my sins, of my own wretchedness, you know. And I realized that I was a sinner who was in need of a savior. Right on that particular evening in that computer lab, you know, I knelt down and I confessed to the Lord that I was a sinner. I acknowledged all my failures and shortcomings, my sins, and my need for a savior. Finally, you know, by God's grace, I confessed my sins and I was saved that
Hallelujah.
Evening. And
Hallelujah.
After my... Amen. Hallelujah. After my new birth, you know, I felt so hungry and thirsty for God and for his word. And before my conversion, you know, I didn't even know how to pray properly. I didn't have any desire to know God, etc. But now, you know, God was so real to me. And I really thank God for saving a worthless sinner like me. And, you know, I really thank God for dying for me on the cross. And you know, there is no way that I can become righteous in front of a holy, holy, holy God merely by my works. And there's absolutely no way I could just, you know, wipe out and cancel out my sins regardless of how many good works I do. So that in a nutshell is who I am, where I come from, and how I was drawn to Christ and how I became a born-again Christian.
That is a wonderful story, my brother. You know, forgive me to ask this. I don't want it to sound as if only those who come from a Muslim background say face persecution or oppression or isolation. Did you face anything when I accepted Christ, whether immediately from your family maybe or from friends? Whether, you know, serious oppressions and persecution or maybe jokingly at the beginning that evolved into something serious?
Thankfully, you know, I grew up in a Christian family. Most of my relatives, everyone is Christian. So I was surrounded by a Christian family, Christian relatives, and a lot of Christian friends as well. So when I became a born-again Christian, thankfully, I didn't undergo any you know, typical persecution or ostracization or any such thing, thankfully. However, you know, when I started to take on, you know, the Islamic polemics and started to write articles and started to make my videos, that's when I got into a little trouble. And trouble meaning, like, you know, some of my friends were upset at me who were Muslims. You know, they felt like I was trying to attack them and put them down or insult them, you know. And some of my close friends, families, and relatives, you know, they sort of warned me to not, you know, engage myself in such kind of polemics because you know how risky it can get, you know. So rightfully, they were warning me, trying to warn me. But, you know, thankfully, God reminds us again and again that he hasn't put in us a spirit of fear. And, Amen. You know, God reminded me of the scriptures that he who is in us is greater than the one who is in the world. So with those comforting verses and words, you know, I was able to continue witnessing to Muslims and write articles and continue to make my videos. So to answer your question, you know, there was no specific kind of persecution or trouble as such. Yeah.
Very good. Hold your thoughts. I want to thank again our moderators. Everybody, please pay close attention. I think Fred Samford listed our policies and our rules. We appreciate everyone who comes here. You are welcome all the time until you start distracting, disrespecting, and using, you know, bad language. Only then I personally will remove you. Just because I'm paying attention to my guests, don't think I'm ignoring what's going on. So I appreciate you at least coming here to be civil, interact with us, ask questions. We're not here to prevent you from doing so, by the way. We welcome your interactions, especially if you have specific questions for our guests. So if you have any questions throughout this particular show for our guests, please make sure you highlight him. We have amazing moderators who are paying attention to everything you are mentioning. Thank you for those who have just gave to our ministry through the super chat. We appreciate you. By the way, we are, I think, about 6 more subscribers away from hitting a huge milestone, 30,000 subscriptions. So thank you so much again for following us. Brother, you obviously grew up in India. Were you surrounded by also Muslim communities in the area where you grew up? Because I know India is as a vast subcontinent.
Absolutely. You know, I had so many friends who were Muslims. I grew up among them and I visited them quite often. I also, you know, played with them sports, and I went to school with them. I had so many Muslim friends in school, in college, and I used to also visit their homes during the Eid festivals, and we used to have food together. Wonderful people, brother. I mean, they're just so strong in their faith and so passionate about their faith. And yes, so I did, you know, I grew up with a lot of Muslim friends, and I was my neighborhood was also pretty surrounded by lots of, you know, Muslims. And we used to hear all the adhan sounds and recitations over the loudspeaker. So yes, I was pretty much immersed in that culture and in that religion. Yes.
So when you accepted Christ, did you feel right away that you wanted just to share with Muslims, or were you just, you know, sharing with anyone, and maybe later on you began to shift your focus to a specific group?
You know, that's a very good question, because after I came to faith, you know, initially I wasn't aware of the field of apologetics, you know, when I just used to casually like go online on the social media, you know, I used to see a lot of disbelief and mockery of God, and, you know, many people would ridicule God and ridicule people who believed in God. But, you know, when you are a believer in Christ, you know, you are burdened when you see such kind of mockery and ridicule. We start to care for people who are not born again. We are burdened to witness to them, you know. We are burdened to share about the love of Christ with them. So initially, I was just witnessing to people in my own small way. I would try to witness to atheists in the beginning. I would give them my own personal testimony of who I was and how the Lord saved me, how He forgave my sins, etc. However, I didn't know the mainstream apologetical arguments, you know. I didn't know how to present logical case using all the, you know, classical arguments. And then personal testimony, of course, didn't go down too well with the atheists, as you can imagine. I started to read books, watch lots of YouTube videos and debates of theists versus atheists. So that was a very small beginning of my apologetics journey. Initially, I was focusing mainly on the atheists. You know, I had a great burden to prove that God existed and that He loves us so much because of my own personal experience. So the beginning was very, if I can say, like clueless. I had no idea what to expect and the, you know, field of apologetics. So that was my general beginning of apologetics.
Okay, so walk us now through how you began to shift your focus more and more to interact with Muslims. I'm not saying you're not interacting with atheists or others, but it's, mm-hmm. I noticed, you know, I by the way, pay attention to anything on my page or anything on my channels, and I know the people that know their stuff or not. Not that I'm saying people who are here to learn and to advance in their knowledge and learn tools are, you know, some. I look down at you. Not at all. Please forgive me. That's not what I mean. Of course, I'm talking to those who are watching, but I appreciate those who also have the knowledge, because I'm always looking for people to come to my pages to carry some of the burden that I have, because I cannot answer all questions. I cannot interact with everybody. So I've always appreciated you and few others that are engaging, you know, our Muslim friends, but you know also what you're sharing with them as well. So what got you into that field, the passion? Did you Let me ask it this way. Mm-hmm. Did you know things about Islam before you accepted Christ and that's why you gravitated towards it? Or is it that the friendship and the things that you had with the Muslims also burdened you to learn more about them?
Sure, sure. So typically, like, this was year 2015. I remember distinctly, you know, I was studying temporarily for an IT subject in a local institute. You know, I used to go there every day to study for my IT classes. And in that institute also, I made some very good friends, you know, and some of them, some among them were, you know, Muslims too. While studying there, you know, I was challenged by one of my Muslim friends. And I just want to say this, clarify this, you know, they were such amazing nice friends that I had, amazing Muslim friends.
I have a wonderful, you know, cousins and friends, of course. Sure. Of course. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I'm still friends with them on the social media, and God bless them, you know, very nice people. However, you know, one of my Muslim friends, you know, he started to ask me that same question that pretty much every Muslim asks of a Christian, you know, where did Jesus say I'm God or worship me, you know? So initially, you know,
did Jesus say that? I mean, because Muslims keep asking me that question and I'm still looking for it.
Me too. I'm still looking for it. You know, maybe I'll have to like start searching my own faith, you know, seriously, you know, there's no such statement. So
I know. You think I'm going to leave, abandon Christ and just walk away because I couldn't find that exact phrase.
You know, initially I found that question to be very strange. You know, I've never thought about it in that specific way, you know, and, you know, as Christians, you know, we have read our scriptures and we know how Jesus claimed to be God by claiming all the divine attributes, divine titles, and the divine nature of God. So I knew that Jesus was God and is God. However, you know, I didn't know how to answer this kind of strange question. I knew all the classical verses from the New Testament on how to prove Jesus is God, but I really didn't know how to answer this kind of question from an apologetical or from a logical standpoint. So that day, you know, I went home and I started to research about that particular question. And that was, in a way, my starting point of my apologetics journey to the Muslim world. And I believe, you know, since I grew up among so many Muslims in that neighborhood, and I had so many friends who were Muslims, you know, probably to answer your original question, maybe that's what motivated me to, you know, start witnessing to Muslims and start studying about their faith and, you know, what kind of arguments they bring against us and things of that nature. Anyway, so I started to do a lot of self-study so that I could properly answer that question. And lo and behold, you know, a few days later, I stumbled upon a video of none other than Dr. Zakir Naik, you know. So that was the first time I came to know about him. I had never heard about him before. I never knew who he was. And I saw one of his very famous videos making that, you know, rapid fire Bible verses speech, which he gave in a debate with Dr. William Campbell. And I was really, really very shocked and horrified by several of his videos and seeing, you know, how he was butchering our Bible verses out of context. So the,
Let me clarify. Are you saying Dr. Zakir Naik doesn't know his stuff? Is that what you're saying, brother?
Well, I would like to say he knows his stuff, but he
takes things out of context. Maybe?
He takes things out of context. He knows that.
So he doesn't know his stuff.
You know, actually, you bring up a good point, because I've seen pretty much all of his videos, and in some of his videos, you know, he's actually complaining about how he was taken out of context. You know, he was complaining left and right, and he was so upset because the local media, you know, they may have taken one snippet of his out of context and showed him in a bad light. So it's kind of ironic, you know.
Yeah, and you know what, brother? You know, people like Zakir Naik are an obstacle in the face of true seeking Muslims who want to know the truth. He will face judgment like no other before. And I can tell you, the guy is an agent of the devil, because he's a liar, and his father is a liar and the father of all lies.
True. You know, I would cut some slack for people who don't know probably, you know, what context means and who are not exposed to the field of apologetics and, you know, like logic and things like that. I would give them some benefit of the doubt, you know, but for people like, you know, Zakir Naik, Ahmed Didat and others, you know, they actually know what they're doing. They know the rules of logic. They know the rules of logic. They've been exposed to our Bible verses, and they know what context means. And, you know, when they do it on purpose, you know, you put it very aptly, you know, they're agent of Satan, you know, and they are out there to lie and deceive. And it's very heartbreaking, actually, you know, what they do. And they are such big obstacles when we bring our ministry for Christ, you know, these are the biggest obstacles we have to face, actually.
So I want to thank everyone again for tuning in to Let Us Reason. With me here, a special guest, a brother in Christ, Ritesh Matthew. And I know I'm not saying his name absolutely correct, so I ask for his forgiveness. What is the name again of your YouTube channel, so that people can hear it, brother? What is it?
Yes, the name of my YouTube channel is Christian Apologetics, correct. Christian Apologetics.
With a plural, with an S, Christian Apologetics. So correct. Please go and inspect his channel. And the reason why I chose our dear brother here today, and I invited him and he kindly accepted, is that I came across a video that he did about taking things out of context. And the thing that cracked me up was that he took words out of Zakir Naik's mouth and created a video that came out of context that will give you an illusion and an impression that Zakir Naik was saying totally different things than what you would expect him to say. And I got the impression and I got the idea right away that this will be cool for us in a show like this to talk about the importance of context and why taking things out of context. And, you know, our Muslim friends sometimes listen to leaders like Zakir Naik and they think somebody like him knows what he's talking about, and therefore whatever they say is almost like written in stone, if you wish. So why don't you now venture into the idea of context and the importance of that?
Mm-hmm. Sure. So just to back up a little bit about Zakir Naik, you know, when I was looking at his videos, you know, I found out how he butchers, you know, our Holy Bible verses out of their literary and historical context. And it's just very shocking, you know, how he pulls one small snippet out of, for example, John chapter 14, verse 28, where Jesus said, "My Father is greater than I." And then he takes another half a quote from I think, John chapter 10, verse 28, where Jesus said, "My Father is greater than all." And then another half sentence from Luke chapter 11, verse 20, where Jesus said, "I cast out devils with the finger of God." And then another half sentence from John chapter 5, verse 30, where Jesus said, "I can of my own self do nothing." So what Zakir Naik did very craftily is, after pulling these small snippets, you know, he joins these four half sentences together, and he creates a very funny narrative about Christ, that Christ was claiming that he is not God. Anyway, so what is this funny word context? What it is and what it means, and how we should communicate in everyday language using the context? So let's probe into this word a little bit and explain to our audience what it means. Before we do that, you know, let's just define and give the classic definition of in context. So the classic definition of in context means, you know, the parts of a written or spoken statement that precede or follow a specific word or passage, usually influencing its meaning or effect. So as the definition suggests, there are parts of a written or spoken speech or a sentence that precede and that follow a particular sentence. And these parts, before and after a sentence, you know, they influence the meaning of a sentence. In other words, if you want to examine one line spoken by someone, you have to take into consideration what he spoke before that one line and what he spoke after that one line, and examine that one line in light of the entire context, you know. So that's in context. Now, what's the definition of out of context? The definition is without the surrounding words or circumstances, and so not fully understandable. So that's how you define out of context. Now, let me just give you an illustration. Let's say President Donald Trump, you know, he gives a small speech on TV, and his speech consists of 50 sentences. Now, if I tell you only one sentence of Trump, you know, will you be able to figure out much of the essence of that speech? No, right? You won't, just from one sentence. You will rightfully ask me, hey, where's the entire speech, you know? You'll ask for all the 50 sentences, and then in light of all the 50 sentences, you're going to interpret that one sentence that I gave you so that you can interpret his speech in context. Now, brother, ever since, you know, men have put their feet on this planet, this is how we have been communicating, you know. We communicate in any language, you know, by using many, many different sentences as a package or as a bundle. So whenever we humans have communicated with one another using any language, we have hardly used only one sentence to explain a deeper point. You know, we use several words, we use several sentences to express our thoughts. That's exactly how, you know, human beings have been communicating for centuries, you know. So the concept of context is not something that is exclusive only to religious texts. Context is not something that you apply only when you are reading the Holy Bible or the Quran or any other religious text. In fact, context is a concept that is applicable in our daily lives, in our daily communication, you know. Exactly. So even when you're reading a newspaper or when you're reading a book or when you're listening to someone's speech on TV, you would want to read and listen to someone in their entirety. So whenever you do any of these, you know, you never ignore other sentences, and you would never rip out one sentence from a newspaper or from someone's speech, you know. So we will read a newspaper article in its entirety to understand the point of that article, you know. So similarly, when we hear someone's speech on TV, you know, we consider the entire speech in context. But, you know, when we pick only half a sentence or one sentence out of a full speech, you know, that half or one sentence, you know, that it loses its meaning and interpretation if you ignore, you know, what was said before and after. So let me just give you a simple illustration. Let's say somebody says 20 sentences to explain a point, right? Now, if you have an enemy, you know, what he can do is if he finds sentence number 11 and 14 that can be used against you, you know, what they do is rip apart only number 11 and number 14, and they ignore the rest of the 18 sentences. And they can actually read number 11 and 14 at face value, and now they can use it against you, you know, and say, hey, Al-Fadi was saying such and such, you know, but they won't give you the entire 20 sentences. That's how you can take someone out of context. Another illustration I can think of is, let's say you, there are a few friends in a house, in a room, and they're having a friendly conversation, right? And suddenly you enter that room and you hear one last line that was said by somebody, and probably that last line sounded really strange to you. You're like, wait a minute, that sounds very funny, you know? If I don't tell you the entire conversation before that last line. You know, you're not going to be able to fully understand and interpret that sentence, you know. So you enter the room and you're like, wait a minute, what did that person just say? You know, it sounds so strange and absurd, you know. So then you inquire and somebody tells you, wait, wait, you know, don't misunderstand me. That before that last line, you know, the person said such and such a thing. And before that, another one said such and such thing. So now what you do is, you know, you tie that entire conversation together. And in light of that entire conversation, now you're going to interpret that last line that you had just heard. Now, you know, it makes sense to you. And you go like, aha, you know, now I understood that last sentence in light of the entire conversation. Now it doesn't sound absurd to you anymore. And now it makes perfect sense to you, you know. So that is the essence of reading something or hearing something in context. Now,
so
yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, if you could, I want to just, you know, mention to people that you are in the process of sharing some examples. So if everybody is wondering where we're going with this.
So you want me to give examples from the
when you're ready, Bible verses? I just want people to know that we are going to give tangible examples
from the Bible.
Please, yes, yeah, that will
sure,
be helpful.
Sure, sure. So typically, you know, what I have seen, and I'm sure most of our viewers have also seen, when our Muslim friends, when they present Bible verses, you know, they love to take, for example, Numbers chapter 23, verse 19 out of context, where it says, God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Hath he said and shall he not do it? Or hath he spoken and shall he not make it good? So again, you know, we shouldn't rip only five words out of that entire sentence. God is not a man, you know. From that verse, they want to prove that Jesus is not God because God is not a man. But again, if you just finish reading that sentence, and even if you ignore the surrounding sentence, that sentence itself gives you the interpretation. You know, what it's trying to tell us is God is not a man that he should lie, right? And he's not a son of man that he should repent. So in essence and nature, God is not a man who will say something but who will not fulfill. You know, as human beings, we make promises and we break them. We also, many a times, we say a lie, you know. So God is not a man like us who should lie or who should, you know, make false promises. However, that particular verse in context doesn't restrict God from taking on human flesh if he chooses to do so, you know. So that particular verse in no way is implying that God cannot take on a human flesh. So this is one example of how, you know, they take verses out of context.
And I want to add to what you just said, because context, when it comes to the Bible, it could be mm-hmm. immediate context right away, but sometimes mm-hmm. that chapter, sometimes that particular letter, sometimes mm-hmm. the author in other sure. places, sometimes the New Testament, sometimes the Old Testament. But my favorite is that the whole Bible, you have to take it in context. And in this case, it's an excellent example that you brought up from Numbers 23, sure. where our Muslims, of course, always use that as a proof. See, it says God is not a man. Wait a minute. Mm-hmm. Read it in context to see mm-hmm. what God is talking about. But regardless of this, which part of this wasn't clear when it says, and the word became flesh sure. and dwelt among us? Mm-hmm. How come you ignore that also? I mean, it supports what you just said. He's not a man in his nature, but he's telling you that at some point in history, he entered into our time. He took on the likeness of, the form of a servant in a likeness of man, and so on and so forth.
Sure. And also to add to your literary context and the context of a letter, also the historical context, you know, sometimes there is a certain circumstance or a situation based on which, you know, something was said in the Old Testament or the New Testament. So you have to look at the historical context as well, in under which circumstances was something said in the Old Testament, right? So yes, the historical context is also something that our Muslim friends need to take into account. Another very famous verse that is taken out of context is from Mark chapter 10, verse 18, where Jesus said, you know, why do you call me good? Nobody is good except God. So our Muslim friends must not stop and just rip apart one sentence, because if you read Mark chapter 10, verse 18. The immediate context starts from verse 17 and goes all the way up to 22. You know, Jesus is actually trying to open up that rich young ruler to his own assumptions and to his own presuppositions, you know. Let me just give you a simple example to that may drive the point home. I love to use this example, although it's not very appropriate and may not catch all the nuances and subtleties of our theology. However, I think it will drive the point home. Let's say, for example, Prince Charles, right? He goes to, like, let's say, Somalia for a special mission, right? And as a part of that mission, you know, he has to leave aside all his royal authority, royal robes, and everything aside, and he has to go to Somalia as a common man. Let's just assume, right? Now, when he goes there, you know, let's say one day somebody approaches him and calls him Your Highness. So immediately, you know, Prince Charles is going to take a step back and say, hey, why did you call me Your Highness, you know? In other words, do you believe that I am the prince coming from Buckingham Palace? And are you willing to obey me? If you called me Your Highness, you know, do you really believe that I'm Your Highness? I'm a king. And are you willing to put everything aside? And are you willing to obey me and follow me? So that's exactly the essence of that particular verse. Jesus is opening up that man to his own assumptions and presuppositions. So if that man called Jesus good, does he know the implications of what that means? You know, so Jesus is asking him that, why do you call me good? You know, nobody's good except God. So do you believe that I'm God? And are you willing to abandon everything that you have and to obey me and follow me? And lo and behold, you know, the way it ends, if you just finish that passage up to verse 22, that man becomes so sad when he hears that he has to abandon everything. Now it becomes clear that even though he called Jesus good, he really didn't believe that Jesus was God. So Jesus accurately opened him up, you know, to his assumptions and to his presuppositions, and proved, Jesus actually proves that that man wasn't calling him good because he believed that Jesus is God. So it's a fantastic question, brother. And far from it undermining Jesus's deity, you know, it actually affirms his deity, because that man, even though he had everything and he was obeying God since his childhood, now he had to actually abandon everything, obey God, and follow Jesus, actually. So that actually proves that Jesus is God, you know. So that's another passage that came to my mind.
Exactly. And that's an excellent point, because Jesus tied, you know, the obedience to God to following him. Mm-hmm. And of course, once again, we take it into context. Jesus says later, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Amen. You see, that's another and Jesus mentioned, you know, I go to my Father, you know, and mm-hmm. he says, I came from heaven. So mm-hmm. if you look at it in context, the picture becomes very clear about the nature of Christ, the mm-hmm. purpose of Christ, the destiny of Christ, and so on and so forth. But when you start nitpicking, and you yes. take one word here and one word there, well, mm-hmm. you know what? We can do this to the Quran all day long. I mean, it's not a big deal at all.
Amen. Amen. Not just the Quran. I mean, I challenge all the listeners right now, you know, go and look at any video, like, let's say, for example, Barack Obama or Donald Trump, and take one video, pick half a sentence that sounds funny or interesting to you. Take a second video of Donald Trump, pick another snippet. Take a third video, pick another snippet, and so on and so forth, and then join them together. You know, you can practically prove anything in this world. If you start chopping people's words and sentences, sky is the limit. You know, I challenge all the viewers, you know, try to do this with anyone's speech and see what kind of funny narrative you come up with, you know. And that's exactly what Zakir Naik does to the Holy Bible, you know. Exactly. And that's the, go ahead, sorry, I'm sorry.
No. I was going to say, our Lord himself, mm-hmm. you know, handled Satan, the father of all lies, when he tried to take things out of context, and the Lord corrected him multiple times. Just go Amen. To the temptation in the wilderness, Matthew 4 and Luke 4, and see how the Lord basically mocked Satan. Is like, really? Is that what it says? You know, so and mm-hmm. he corrected his manipulation of the scripture.
Right. You know, I'm so glad that you brought that point up, because isn't that a scary and chilling thought that even Satan can quote scriptures. That's so, so scary, brother.
And he masquerades as an angel of light. I mean, what does that tell you about what Mo said at the cave, you know?
Sure. So the point is, anyone can quote a scripture. I can go and quote one snippet of Donald Trump. I can go ahead and quote just one snippet from the Quran, you know? So even Satan can quote. So what we appeal to our Muslim friends, and not just them, everyone who is reading any literature, to not just quote the Bible verse, because anyone can quote, including Satan, you know. But what you have to do is you have to have the ability to do proper and sound hermeneutics, to exegete the Bible verse, look at the surrounding verses. And coming up with the interpretation is the harder challenge, you know. So anyone can quote, but not everyone can properly interpret and draw proper meaning out of it. So, and that's exactly what Zakir Naik does to our Bible, you know. It's so, and that's why, you know, when I made my refutation video, you know, I really wanted to like turn the tables back on them. And just how you do it, brother, you know, you give everyone a taste of their own medicine in a nice way. I mean, I'm not saying it in a demeaning way, but I think that's the best way to do logic. I think if somebody comes up with something silly and absurd, you know, the best way probably is to just turn the tables back on them and give them a taste of their own medicine. So that's precisely why I took that route when I was making my refutation video against Zakir Naik. I nitpicked several snippets of his from different videos and I joined them together to prove that he's an atheist. He's a vegetarian man, you know, he doesn't eat meat. So just watch my video and see what you can do. Once you start with that kind of methodology of interpretation, boy, it's just crazy. There's simply no limit, you know.
Absolutely, and I agree with you. I mean, for instance, as simple as when Muslims ask us about the word Trinity, well, okay, I'll turn the table around. Show me the word Tawheed, you know. That's simply taking things out of context. In this case, the concept itself. You know, when Muslims say, well, show me, where did Jesus say, I am God, worship me? I'll say, okay, well, show me, where did Allah say, I am the God of the Muslims, worship me? I mean, if you want to play this game, I'll play this game all day long. I mean, I got plenty of that kind of stuff.
Right. And that's one tip I want to, I would like to give our Christian friends when they are dialoguing with Muslims, you know, don't just start explaining to them something. Just take a step back, you know, and then ask them, like, for example, if a Muslim quotes a Bible verse, take a step back instead of explaining to them right away, you know, ask them questions and ask them to go to our Christian websites and look at our tafsirs. You know, that's another thing that our Christian brothers and sisters, they lack in witnessing to Muslims. Ask them to go to I think it's BibleStudyTools.com, and there is another free website called BibleHub.com. Go to these, ask your Muslim friend to go to these websites and give them, give you, you know, the expert commentaries from our side. Don't just start answering their question. This is one tip I learned myself. You know, initially I would just start to be defensive and, you know, just start explaining. But then I realized, wait a minute, you know, this is, the approach they're taking is not very honest, you know, so I need to take a step back and, you know, deal accordingly. Sorry, you were saying something.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, I love it when a Muslim comes to me and tell me in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18, it talks about the prophet, you know, in the book of Habakkuk. And my question is, when was the last time a Christian went to Deuteronomy 18 and went to the book of Habakkuk? And if a Muslim labored enough to do the Google search, then I tell the Muslims, you know what? You've done half the work. Why don't you go and finish it now? Do sure. Google search. You'll find the answer to your questions.
For sure. So absolutely. I mean, just take a step back and just ask them to provide you with all the tafsirs. Because let's be honest, you know, our Bible theology, it's so rich. It's so deep. You know, our Bible was written by 40 different authors, of course, inspired by the Holy Spirit. And it was written within a span of 1500 years. And there were 40 men of God, you know, involved. And there are 66 books. And, you know, there are so many men and women of God on our side. You know, they take years and years to study the Holy Bible just so they can interpret it properly. You know, they go for years and years in the Christian seminary. So none of us is a Bible expert to be or a Quranic expert, you know. So we don't have any right to just quote a verse and then contradict the entire, like, you know, systematic theology and butcher things out of context. We don't have any right to do that. That's why it's our responsibility to show a proper context, and also, if possible, you know, show the expert commentaries, the mainstream commentaries. You know, we can't just quote a verse and just, you know, take it at face value as a standalone verse, you know. So this is my advice to all our brothers and sisters, you know. Another verse that comes to my mind is from Matthew chapter 10, verse 34, you know, where Jesus said,
that's my favorite.
I haven't come I've come to bring a sword, you know, that one, you know, that's another passage that they butcher it out of context. You know, you just, Exactly. All you have to do is just give that courtesy and respect to Jesus and just let him finish his speech. You know, that's all you have to do in order to interpret it correctly. You know, he clearly explains in the following verses, 35 to 39, where he says, you know, a man will be against his father, and a daughter will be against her mother, and a daughter-in-law will be against her mother-in-law. So he's talking about the division that will be caused because of his name's sake. You know, he didn't bring a sword. You know, how many people did Jesus slaughter with a sword, with a physical sword? How many people did his disciples slaughter with a physical sword, you know? So that means, are you trying to tell me they were worst followers of Jesus who didn't obey his commands, and Jesus himself didn't preach what he preached? Are you trying to tell us that, you know, when you butcher it out of context and say, hey, Jesus was a violent man and, you know, he came to use a sword? So that's the kind of, you know, funny interpretation that you can make out of Bible verses. Once you ignore the context and butcher and chop off, you know, it's just absurd, you know. It's you're not going to go anywhere with that kind of interpretation. So
absolutely. And brother, by the way, a lot of people asking about your channel. I don't know, do you see the chat box, by the way? Can you put the channel in there? Otherwise, you can send it to me and I'll make sure I'll post it for you. Or if you know the URL, is it under the name, or
I don't have the URL right now, unless the one
you
that
can
I
send it to me and I'll make sure I'll post it there.
Yes, the name of the channel is called Christian Apologetics. So I don't know if they can just type Christian Apologetics and pull it up, or
I tried, you know, it takes you to different channels that are based on apologetics also. So sometimes people may not find it really directly.
I can try and post one video link. And let me see. Hold on just a second. Here we go.
Yeah. If you can do that, that would be great. In light of what our dear brother is talking about, and you can see why I brought him here, first to show you that doing ministry among Muslims does not require you to be an ex-Muslim. That's number one. Number two, doing ministry among Muslims requires you to do your homework as well and be familiar with their arguments. And sometimes you may have to engage with them, even on a social media platform, for instance, or in person. But another important thing is context. Context is key. Context is like king, you know? Mm-hmm. If you do not use context at all, then unfortunately, you are going to mislead yourself and you are going to be misled one way or another. You have no idea how many times I've been asked by people about something that the Muslim person told them. Said, did you know that Muhammad is found in the Song of Solomon's? Really? Really? I mean, are you serious about that? But a person, you know, will run away, run with that and look at the passage and not realize really what's going on. And it's important, by the way, for us to know even sometimes the original language. And you mentioned a lot of free tools that are available easily online, you know, Blue Letter Bible, you know, Bible Gateway, Bible Hub. And if you're really the scholar, you can get the stuff that we use, Logos, you know, and things of that nature, because you'll be able to tell right away what's going on. But context is extremely important. Now, if you don't mind me, brother, I want to just share one example, for instance, with our brothers and sisters here. From the Bible itself, by the way, mm-hmm. From the Bible itself, When you, for instance, go to Romans chapter 12, Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, if you are not going to use Romans 12, 1 and 2 in context, along with the rest of the chapter, then you're going to miss the point completely. You know, Romans 12, verses 3 to 8, for instance, talks about the gifts of the church. But to in order for you to understand the gifts as a believer in a church, you need to understand that you must be transformed, that your mind must not conform to the world, but rather to be transformed so that you can start serving others because you know that you are different. You know, that's one example. In Philippians, chapter 2, one of my favorite passages in there that talks about our Lord basically taking on the form of a servant in the likeness of man. And that's, you find this in Romans 2, verses 5 to 11. But you have to understand, the whole chapter is telling you something about humility, humbleness, and serving others. And Jesus was used as an example. You can't just pick and choose and assume that you understood what is intended in there, because sometimes it can deceive even a believer if they play this game of taking things out of context.
Amen, amen. I'm glad you said that, because I've seen some Christians as well, you know, unknowingly, you know, they just pick one sentence and they interpret that one sentence at face value. And it could really, you know, mislead even Christians. So even we, all of us, have to be careful when we are interpreting our scriptures, you know. Excellent. To avoid that kind of confusion and division, you know. That's why we sadly have some divisions, you know, because people don't interpret the Holy Bible verses within its intended context, you know. And the Bible's author is not a human, you know. We all have to be careful that Bible is a book of God. He's the author. So if I write a book, I wouldn't want people to distort my speech and render it out of context. I would be very upset. Here we are dealing with the holy text. It's the word of God. So we have, all of us, it's a big responsibility for each one of us, you know, to take everything in context and try to come up with the proper interpretation.
Absolutely. And, you know, some of my favorite, you know, passages that deal with context in the Bible, in the book of Acts chapter 8, for instance, when Philip was basically snatched by the Holy Spirit and he met the Ethiopian eunuch, and the Ethiopian eunuch heard the Ethiopian eunuch reading from Isaiah. Mm-hmm. And he was asking him about, who is it? Is it Isaiah who's saying this? It says that starting with the scripture, he began to explain to him. So he put things in context.
In context.
Our Lord, on the way to Emmaus, when he met the two basically sad disciples after the crucifixion of Christ, he told them, really, fools, and he opened their minds to begin to understand the scripture, and he began to share with them why the Christ must suffer. But he showed them the suffering according to what? To the law of Moses, to the Psalms and the prophets. Why? Amen. Jesus read things in context.
In
John chapter 5, verse 38 and 39, the Lord mocked the Pharisees and says, "Search the scripture." Amen. In other words, you're taking things out of context and you don't know what's going on, but it testifies about me when you put it in context. So all of these are extremely important examples.
Amen. Amen. And I love the phrase that our late dear Dr. Ravi Zacharias, you know, he used, "A text without context is pretext." Pretext meaning it's just a reason to justify anything. So we all may have certain biases and prejudices from where we come from. And because of our bias, we may put our own meaning to a certain text, you know, and it becomes a pretext without any context. And we can use a text to our advantage to gain anything and to distort, you know. So that's a wonderful phrase I really love from our late Dr. Ravi Zacharias.
Yes, sir. I agree with you. And of course, his memorial service, I believe, will be tomorrow. And it will be, you know, live streams worldwide. So people can go and search for the time. Mm-hmm. Brother, it's hard to believe that we are approaching the end of our live stream. But thank you so much, of course, for taking the time to be with us. Obviously, you and I will continue our interaction to see if there are any other specific things that we can do shows on topics and things like that. To the rest of you, thank you so much to my viewers for being here. Please go and subscribe to our brother's YouTube channel and go and watch that video that I mentioned to you about Zachariah. And thank you again for bringing us to over this milestone, everyone, the 30,000 milestone of subscribers. The next one is 100,000 now. And the reason why we get excited about this, because YouTube controls what you can do at certain levels. You know, at 10,000, they allow you certain things. At 20,000, they allow you other things. At 30,000. And so we get excited because we want to make sure we reach the masses and be able to capitalize on every tool that is available to us. Our time is short and limited. And we want to serve the Lord as much as we can with everything that we have. And we're thankful for platforms like this that allow us to do those kind of things. Thank you to our moderators. Thank you for those who gave through the super chat. And we really appreciate your sacrifices. And here is some things. Tomorrow, I'll advertise it, of course, at the same time at 6 p.m. Eastern time, New York time, 11 p.m. London time. I'm going to have a dear brother. Robert Spencer will be with me and we'll talk about the history of jihad. And on Sunday, we're going to have our friend Mike Westerfield, who is an ex-Muslim. And we will be talking about the psychology of Islam. So stay tuned for this announcement. And next week, we're going to have more special shows that we will advertise for you. Brother, thank you again. Any final words, any final advice you want to share with people, especially in the context of reaching Muslims?
Yes. I think as the word of God says, you know, the harvest is plenty and the laborers are few. So please, you know, participate and you know, support our dear brother who is doing such a wonderful ministry. Support him spiritually, financially, in whatever ways you can. And I think we are living in very exciting times. You know, everything is at our fingertips, you know, and we can reach out to hundreds, if not thousands, in a matter of a few minutes. So, you know, spreading the word, doing evangelism and apologetics is so exciting in these times. You know, God has made us so easy for each one of us. So do participate. And I know it could be a little risky when you engage in Islamic polemics, but that's what we are called to do, you know, by our Lord. You know, we are called to preach his word at any cost. So don't be afraid, you know, press on, continue with your good work and you know, just be useful in the kingdom of God. Because as our dear brother said, you know, time is limited and laborers are really, really very few. And I don't see too many people engaging in dialogues with atheists and Muslims. So yeah, don't be afraid and you know, may God bless you and continue with your good work. And thank you also, brother, for having me on your show.
Absolutely. It's an honor, brother. And I just want to leave a quick message to Somali Christian TV. You are next on the block, my friend. You will receive an email and we would love to interact with you and see when you can join us. We will be honored to have you here. Thank you, brother. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
And glory to God. God bless you all. Take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye.